Oh, it's okay. We're blaming you for the, did you hear about that?
I didn't know what I was doing, I was making up stuff, I'll just leave. It was all due. The follower. The person who made it.
Let's take a look at number nine, on 34. Says at a distance of 10 kilometers from the radio transmitter, the amplitude of the E field is 0.2 volts per meter. What is the total power emitted by the radio transmitter? The radio transmitter will tell the amplitude of the E field is 0.2 volts per meter. So we could get the energy density of that signal, average energy density, as 1/2 epsilon naught maximum amplitude squared. So we have 1/2 times 8.85 times 10 minus 12. 0.2 volts per meter squared gives us an energy density of 1.77 times 10 minus 13 joules per cubic meter. And we want to find the power emitted by the radio transmitter. This is the energy density. Well, we can get the intensity from the energy density, I see you. And so power or intensity is equal to the power per area. So the power will equal the intensity times the area. So that would be CU times the area. And if you had a transmitter, what would be the area that you'd be talking about in this case? If you look at the area of a sphere, you have the radius that you're away from that transmitter. In other words, transmitting in all directions at some radius r. And so all that energy is being distributed over that area. That's why you're going to be intensive in the first place. And so the area that we're looking at area of that sphere, 4 pi r squared. So this is going to be C times U times 4 pi r squared. Power equals 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second times energy density, 1.77 times 10 to the 13. 4 pi times 10 kilometers, 10 to the 4th meters squared. That comes out to 66,727 watts, or approximately 67. Number 7. Let me do number 7. Determine the amount of energy carried in 1 meter of a 3.5 milliwatt helium neon laser beam at the cross-sectional area of the beam is 5 times 10 to the minus 6 square meters. We'll greatly exaggerate this helium neon laser beam. The cross-sectional area equal to 5 times 10 to the minus 6 square meters. And we're going to look at a length of 1 meter of this beam. So the volume will be equal to the volume of this cylinder, which would be the cross-sectional area times length. I guess that would be 5 times 10 to the minus 6 cubic meters. I multiply that by 1 meter. We want to find the amount of energy in that, and the power was given is 3.5 milliwatts. Of course, power is equal to intensity per area, and intensity is equal to power per area. Power is equal to intensity times area. And intensity is also equal to C times the energy density. So we have power will be to C times the energy density times the area. Total energy, we call the energy density times the volume. If we had energy density within space, and we multiply by the volume of that space, we get the energy contained in that space. So let's see what we got here. Let's rearrange this, saying that energy density is equal to the power divided by speed of light times the area. Let's put that in there. The volume is the area times the length. And I already figured out the volume, but we didn't need to do it. So we can cross out the area here. That's power times the length or speed of light. 3.5 times 10 minus 3 watts. That's 1 meter. 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. And I get 1.17 times 10 minus 11. So that would be the energy contained in 1 meter. 3.5 milliwatt helium neon laser. What do you think? Anything else look interesting? It doesn't look too bad. Are there some problems with 35? Maybe if we order something new, the difference?
Who's
is all down with the land. Wow. Let's start chapter 36.
Said that it is exactly the frequency of blue light, so that's what it reflects, and it's a reflection of blue light.
So it's constructive interference.
Right. It's not
a reflection.
But there's no pigmentation.
That's great stuff.
Yeah.
I need to find that incorporated. Mirrors and lenses. Actually, a lot of this you may already have a good grip on because you've already done the experiments. Let's talk about it. We define what we call the object distance, which we're going to designate by P in this chapter, as the distance from an object to a mirror or lens. So wherever the object is, that distance to the mirror or lens is P. And the image distance is Q, which is the distance from the image to the mirror. And depending on their location, it could be positive or negative. We'll find that in a moment. Types of images, real and virtual. A real image is one in which the light actually passes through the image point. Real images can be displayed on the screen, so you actually have light creating that image, hence it can be displayed on the screen. A virtual image is one in which light does not pass through the point, and light appears to diverge from that point, appears to come from somewhere where it actually is not coming from, so that would be a virtual image. Not for showing on the screen. Virtual images cannot be shown on a screen. For example, I don't know what I'm thinking. Possible movie line is, you're looking very real today, kid. That's probably what would have been written if I had been the script writer for this famous movie, Casablanca. But the actual line was, here's looking at you, kid. I must have thought this was funny when I first put this together. So, in order to see that image, it would actually have to be a real image. Images are formed at the points the rays actually intersect or appear to originate. To find where an image is formed, it's always necessary to follow at least two rays of light as they reflect in, from the mirror. So if you find where two rays of light might intersect, then that's where your image would be. For instance, look at a simple situation, a flat mirror. You have an object out in front, and we've actually designated two rays of light, one that is from the tip of this object, one that is going straight into the mirror, and then reflecting and coming, bouncing right back. Another one that's going at an angle, actually to the vertex here, or you could say at the center here, and reflecting according to the angle of reflection, law of reflection. And because of this reflection here, this ray appears to be coming along this dotted line from this point up here. And where those two dotted lines intersect is where those two rays appear to be coming from upon reflection from this flat mirror. So that designates the point to where the image is. Actual properties of this image can be determined by geometry, looking at congruent triangles, and we'll do that in a moment. But we can see evidently from this image here that this image is the same height as the object and about the same distance away in the back of the flat mirror. So the image is as far behind the mirror as the object's in front. Image magnitude of the image distance is equal to the magnitude of the object distance. Image height is equal to the object height. Magnification is 1. It's also upright. The image is virtual, so your object distance is determined to be negative. That's because the image is not actually on the side of the actual ray. So because the image is behind the mirror, you don't have real rays composing that image, and hence the image distance is negative. Image is upright, and there's an apparent left to right reversal in the image. Here's an application. Say you have your auto mirror, and you're driving at night, and there's two angles that you could use that mirror at. One where you would get the bright lights of the cars behind you, and one where you would get that light in a more dim setting. If you set this at the daytime setting, and you have light coming in from behind you, comes in, refracts, reflects, comes off, refracts again, and you get this bright image into your eyes on the daytime setting. But if you don't want that bright image in your eyes because your eyes aren't used to it at night, then what you could do is bend the mirror a little bit so that as the instant light comes in, there's a dimmer reflection off this first surface, and as that reflection comes to your eyes, that would be a lot dimmer than, say, the full bright beam that is refracted elsewhere. So you have two settings, one where you get the full beam, one where you just get this dimmer reflection, and that would be your nighttime setting. So you have not overcome by the light.
I think almost all of them are good with that now. They have like an automatic changer. It'll turn like a shade of green. Instead of just flipping the mirror.
Yeah, I'll automatically do it.
Mine's never turned again. My back windows are thin, so.
Yeah.
I got it, but it's
you don't have to worry about that. Multiple images formed by two flat mirrors. Say we had an object here, and of course, with this mirror number 1 down here, there'd be an image located behind this mirror the same distance. And with the second mirror over here, there's an image behind that mirror, the same distance away. There's actually a third image if these two mirrors are at a right angle. So I have images 1 and 2 and mirrors 1 and 2 respectively. A third image is the image of image 1 and mirror 2. In other words, here's the object here, and we might have light coming this way, reflecting off this mirror, coming out here, appearing to come from image 1. And that comes up here, reflects off the second mirror here. And so this light that appears to come from image 1, reflecting off here, appears to come from location over here, image 3. So there's a third image in these plane mirrors at 90 degree angle. Equivalently, it could be the image of image 2 in mirror 1 as well. So we're only depicted it here as the image of image 1, but if my eyes were at a different angle, I could see image 2 reflected off mirror 1 coming from, appearing to come from this location of image 3. Three images. Spherical mirrors. A spherical mirror has the shape of a segment of a sphere. A concave spherical mirror has the silvered surface of the mirror on the inner or concave side of the curve. A convex spherical mirror has the silvered image of the mirror on the outer or convex side of the curve. Trying to keep concave and convex clear, I have a memory device. Here's a K. Here's a con. Imagine that if you look at a cave, it kind of curves in. Caves in. And we would say that we have concave. On the other hand, here's a vexer. Here's a con. We can see from the crystal ball that it is curved outward. Hence, we have been vexed or convex. I don't know how long it takes to figure these things out, but the easy one is concave. Caves in, it's concave. Here's some notation for a concave mirror. Caves in, it's got some radius of curvature, which we assume to come from the center of curvature here, R. We'll label that center of curvature C. Point B is at the center of the spherical segment, the vertex. And a line drawn from C to B is called the principal axis of this mirror. So along this principal axis through the center to the vertex is this line right here. Rays from the object will converge at the image point I and continue to diverge from I. So here's a ray. Comes in, reflects, incident angle equals reflected angle, reflects out, comes through the image point, and same thing over here. So all these lines originating from the object will reflect from the concave mirror and converge on I and then diverge from that point, so that if you were to look at this image, you would actually see actual light coming at you like it was the source of that light. So the image would actually appear to be real because actual real rays are coming at you from that image. Here's what happens with a spherical aberration. Normally, we would assume that the rays are making small angles with the principal axis of the mirror. We want to keep the mirror so it's not so large. But if when the rays make large angles with this mirror, then they may not exactly converge at a point, and that would result in a blurred image. This effect is called spherical aberration. There's a famous case of spherical aberration. What case might I be referring to? Because if you look ahead in the notes, you can see it. The Hubble telescope. Back in the early 90s, the Hubble was put up. It was designed to avoid the Earth's atmosphere so that we could actually see further out into the universe and actually see some distant galaxies and with higher resolution. The problem was, I think one of the mirrors was not, designed based on a wrong measurement system. I think that was the explanation. That was supposed to be in metric, and it was designed in inches.
Yeah, something like that.
So when it was set up and they finally started to look at the images, they were all blurred with spherical aberration. And so this was a major problem. So NASA designed another mission to go up and correct this problem with an extra lens. I think it looks something like this when it was all done. Put in a good refracting lens to correct the problem. And there you have it. Cost about $1 billion, but it was worth it because. Here's one of the pictures from deep space from the Hubble. Every little dot in here is a galaxy.
Wow.
Containing millions of stars.
Which have planets.
Which may have planets, may not, you know. Yeah. So I think in perspective, that even just this one picture is worth billions of dollars that we're spending on the Hubble. Because it puts us makes us think about how vast the universe is.
Yeah.
And it's pretty thin.
Is that one of the deep field pictures?
Yeah, that's one of the deep field pictures. And so if you're looking deep field, you're just looking at a little speck way out there at some radius r. You can imagine that if you're looking at that tiny little speck, at that radius r, there's tiny little specks all over the universe. Only reason we see that image is because there just happens to be a hole in that direction of our perspective. In other directions, you got dust in the universe, you got other objects in the universe, and frankly, you just can't look at everywhere because that would take forever. But that's just looking in one direction and finding a hole that you can actually look that far. Right? So imagine just in all directions that kind of universe.
They're building a new telescope that on the ground it has a bunch of mirrors on it. It's like really huge. It's supposed to be able to see 13 pounds sort of than the Hubble telescope.
From the ground?
Wow. They said to clean the lenses, they're not a carbon based snow light on. And so it'll get on the frozen lens and it runs off, so it almost break water on the electrons. It's an epoxy side.
Well, the problem with the ground is you got all the atmospheric effects to worry about.
Somehow I've got the way they designed it with all the different gear, so figuring out maybe it's a little better. Or where they're putting it. I don't know. Except to see better than normal.
And NASA's putting out another telescope to replace the Hubble, which won't be much better.
I think this is just put on the moon.
Yeah, and the moon is a good spot. do astronomy.
Now they're not, because everybody's rushing back to the moon because of the H3.
Quick note about ray diagrams. We're going to use quite a few here. Types of rays that you can draw. You can draw one ray parallel to the principal axis and reflected back through a focal point. And anything parallel extending into the mirror will reflect back through the focal point. Ray 2 drawn through the focal point and reflected parallel to the principal axis. So if you go through the focal point, you come out parallel. Ray 3 drawn through the center of curvature is reflected back on itself. The center of curvature is the radius, the center of the circle itself. The ray 4 drawn to the principal axis vertex will reflect like a flat mirror. Angle of incidence equals angle of reflection, so that angle will be equal in magnitude above and below the principal axis. There's a note about ray diagrams. We need two of these rays to intersect in order to locate the image of an object. Only two. Third or possibly fourth ray would serve as a check of the construction. Rays actually go in all directions from the object, but we would choose these rays because they're the easiest ones to construct. The image point obtained from the ray diagram must agree with the value of Q calculated from, as we'll see, the mirror equation. Here's an example which we're going to use to calculate magnification. Here I have a concave mirror. I have an object out here. Here's our center of curvature. And we can see I've actually drawn two rays here. One goes to the vertex on the principal axis, making a nice flat-like reflection there where our angle of incidence equals our angle of reflection. And I have another ray that goes right through the center of curvature, bounces off like a flat mirror directly here, and comes right straight back. The intersection of these two rays from this point on the object, the tip of this point, would define the tip of the image right over here. So we construct this ray diagram. It converges at arrow tip at the image. And if we look at this gold triangle, we have a right triangle, and we could say that the tangent of angle theta is equal to the height of the object divided by this length right here, which would be the image distance, because that's the distance the image is from the mirror. And from the blue triangle, we would say that the image height, which we're going to call it negative because it's inverted, would be equal to, or the tangent of this angle would be equal to that negative image height over the object distance. Take the ratio of these two equations, and we would get that the magnification, which is equal to the image height over the object height, would be equal to negative image distance over the object distance, or it's assumed, well, in this case, where both of these are positive quantities because they're both on the same side as the real rays. Also note from the same figure, if I look at these alpha angles here, two lines intersecting, both these angles are equal, and we could say that the tangent of alpha is equal to negative h prime over this distance right here, which would be the radius of this circle minus the image distance. So we're just looking at that little side of that little triangle there. And also the tangent of alpha is equal to h divided by this distance right here, which will be equal to the total object distance minus the radius of this curvature. Take the ratio of those two to get rid of the tangents. And we've got got R minus Q over P minus R equals negative image height over object height, but from the previous magnification equation, that was equal to negative Q over P. So we have a negative negative Q over P. Bear with me. So we have P times R minus Q equals Q times P minus R. A little bit of algebra here. We can get QR plus PR equals QP plus PQ. Factor out the R. A little bit of algebra. We'll get this. 1 over P is 1 over Q. Equals 2 over R. 1 over the object distance plus 1 over the image distance equals 2 over the radius of curvature of the mirror. Nice result. Call that the mirror equation. I take that mirror equation and I put the object infinitely far away, then our image distance will be infinity. I mean, our object distance will be infinity. So 1 over infinity would be 0. That term would be 0. And then our image distance will be equal to r divided by 2. So my object is infinitely far away, so that the rays are actually coming in parallel. They're going to converge on a point, and that will be where our image is at r divided by 2. And we're going to call that point where those parallel rays converge, we'll call it the focal point. And the length of that point from the mirror will be called the focal length. So parallel rays from evidently a infinitely distant object will converge on the focal point, a distance of the focal length. Hence, the focal length is equal to the radius of curvature divided by 2. So, using this idea, focal length is the radius divided by 2, I can rewrite the mirror equation as this. 1 over the object distance plus 1 over the image distance equals 1 over the focal length. Probably one that you've used often already. Here's an actual demonstration of the focal length using parallel rays, which again is probably something. Convex mirror. A convex mirror is sometimes called a diverging mirror. The rays from the main point of the object diverge after reflection as though they were coming from some point behind the mirror. If you were to follow those rays behind the mirror, you would find where your image appears to be. So the image is virtual, meaning that your image distance would be negative because it's actually on the side opposite the real rays, lies behind the mirror, to the point where the reflected rays appeared originally. Right, looks something like this. Here's our object, some distance away from the convex mirror, and here are two rays, one coming in parallel, and it's going to reflect off, and if I actually look at this surface right here, again, our angle of incidence will look equal our angle of reflection, just at that tangent. But if I follow that angle or that ray of reflection, I actually come to a point over here, which would be the focal point of this convex mirror. So actually, a parallel ray coming in will reflect off and appear to come from from the focal point of this convex mirror. Another ray, radially coming in towards the center of curvature of this convex mirror, will reflect straight back and hence appear to come from this location here, where the two intersect would be the tip of that object as far as the image is concerned, and hence that would locate where our image is, behind the mirror. So in general, the image by a convex mirror is going to be upright, virtual, and smaller than the object. Here are sign commitments for mirrors. If you're on the front or real side of the mirror, hence on the real side where the light actually is, then you would assume that your object and your image distances are positive. You're actually on the same side as the light. And if you find that your object or image is actually on the side where there's actually no light, on the back side of the mirror, then those values for the object or image distance would be negative. So in front, positive, and back, negative. Image height, upright image, positive, inverted image, negative. Same thing for magnification. You see that these conventions that we define will be consistent with what we define for lenses later on. Here's a ray diagram for a concave mirror. Actually, you have three rays drawn here. One parallel comes in, reflects off through the focal point. One comes in through the center of curvature, bounces straight back. One comes in through the focal point on its way there, reflects parallel back. And where these three rays converge is actually where the tip of the image is. So in this case, this image is real and inverted. So the object is outside the center of curvature of the mirror. Image is real. Image distance is positive. You're on the real side of the rays. Image is inverted, magnification will be negative, and the image is smaller than the object, so magnification would be less than 1 in magnitude. But if you are inside the focal length for your object, you might have a ray diagram that looks like this. You have a parallel ray coming in, reflects off through the focal point. You've got another ray that comes in along the radius of curvature, and that reflects straight back through the center of curvature. You have another ray that comes in along the line from the focal point, and that reflects parallel outward. And where those three rays appear to converge would actually be behind the mirror at this point right here. The object's between the mirror and the focal point. The image is virtual because it's behind the mirror on the side where the real rays are not. So the image distance is negative. The image is upright because magnification is a negative Q over P. And if Q is negative, then you're going to have a positive magnification. And the image is larger than the object, so your magnitude, your image distance is greater than your object. Here's a ray diagram for a convex mirror. Just in general, I think we looked at one of these already. We have one ray headed towards towards the focal point reflects parallel outward. We have a parallel ray coming in, appears to come from the focal point. And we have one ray along the radius of curvature, headed towards the center of curvature, reflects straight back. Where these three rays appear to come from is where the image is. Object's front of the convex mirror, the image is virtual, because our image distance is negative. Image is upright, magnification is negative Q over P. Image is smaller than the object, so magnification, magnitude magnification is less than 1. Here is a summary. For a concave mirror, the image may be either real or virtual. If the object is beyond the focal point, then the image is real. When the object is at the focal point, the image is infinitely far away. And when the object is between the mirror and the focal point, the image is virtual, behind the mirror. For a convex mirror, the image is always virtual and upright. When the object distance increases, the virtual image gets smaller and smaller. So a convex mirror would be a good thing to have in the store. You always want to see what's going on. Here's a magician's illusion. Say an object, you illuminate it to create the, well, be a source of light. And you have yourself a nice mirror. So you create a real image of that object somewhere else. And if it converges very well, then someone else might actually think that object exists there because it appears to come from that, the light appears to come from that point. Whereas it might not actually be there. So a lot of times when magicians make something disappear or appear, it's a clever use of mirrors. Yes.
You couldn't do that on something big as like a space shuttle, though, right?
Yes.
I don't know. I've seen that.
Yeah.
Somebody make the Statue of Liberty. David Copperfield.
Mm-hmm. Somebody did the space shuttle.
Somebody did a space shuttle.
And then they like actually went through the object area both times to like feel like they had spectators go and like they felt the shuttle and it was really there. And then afterwards they were like going through it and there was nothing there.
Huh.
I've always wondered how you did that one.
Yeah, I don't really trust the spectators.
Yeah.
Well, would you not see the mirror? Big, huge mirror making something big, huge disappear?
Maybe if you're looking for it.
That's a magician. I don't
know. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there's more complicated, ruses that you can set up. But to actually go out there and touch the shuttle.
They were hurt.
Here's an illusion, a popular illusion. Trying to grab the object. Well, actually, the hand disappears. That's the illusion. The object stays there. I don't know how to do that. Put a big mirror out here somewhere. Here's how that might work. We actually have an object at the focal point of the top mirror, a concave mirror. So it's at this point right down here. And rays from that object stand out here, hit this top mirror, and since they're at the focal point, any rays coming in to this mirror are going to come out parallel from that first concave mirror. So those rays come out parallel, and the bottom mirror is the same mirror, same kind of mirror, so it's got the same focal length. So as these rays come in parallel, those rays will converge on the focal point of this bottom mirror, hence creating a real image, a very good real image, at the opening of the top. Hence, put the object at the bottom, two concave mirrors with the same focal lengths, and converge. Everyone should have. There's a mirror situation in the Pyrenees, a solar furnace. I think depending on the location of the sun, and reflecting off all these other mirrors onto this concave mirror here, which is focusing all that energy on its focal point, which is this location right here.
Yeah, the only one I've ever seen is a black sensitive syringe in Mexico. We use it for thermal testing weapons.
Thermal testing weapons, so they put the weapons at the focal point?
Pretty much.
What kind of thermal are we talking about? What kind of temperature are we talking about?
I don't know. I just know it's a pretty big mirror. It's pretty cool to see up close. It's really bright. So, yeah, I'll stare at it.
I'd like to see more of these things. Yeah. You know, it's nice to utilize solar energy if possible.
And also what's real cool is they had this one. It's shaped sort of like a half pipe, and it pipes like an oil through it, and it gets a couple thousand degrees centigrade, I believe, and it heats the oil.
That
it, like, turns the generator pretty much.
Because the oil is becomes a gas, and the pressure of that turns the generator. And then it condenses, and then goes the whole cycle. Kind of like a closed cycle.
Yeah.
Neat.
There's all kinds of applications.
Is that on the mountain?
Yes. On the mountain.
Would that not work as well in the surface?
Would that what?
Would that not work as well in the surface?
Well, you're getting more light, kind
of. Yeah, I think the idea is that, of course, you got the mountains to deal with, but that you're a little bit open, you know, with that, without your normal civilization.
You've got a lot of these in the desert countries, like Saudi Arabia and Libya.
A lot of these?
Mm-hmm.
Come to buy desert land.
Yeah.
It's going to become important.
No, we have plenty of desert land.
Yeah.
In Texas. in between Dallas and Los Angeles, right there.
Makes you appreciate Texas that much more, huh?
I really think all that land that's out there that's not even being utilized, if they just put huge fields and fields of solar panels just everywhere they could
supply
energy. Are they talking about putting solar panels on the moon and sending the energy back using light streams?
Or microwave?
Sounds what?
Well, that just seems like that's an awfully complicated way to do something.
No, it's a communication. Yeah. You send it back using light.
If we can't even figure out how to use solar panels and stuff like that on Earth, hydropower, we're thinking about putting stuff on the moon.
We've experimented with transferring energy from microwaves. They do that in Mars.
Yeah, I think we can do a whole lot in that direction. I think we neglected to do so. Time for the next generation to do that. Images formed by refraction. We're looking at some mirrors. Let's consider a material, it could be glass, has a higher index of refraction than, say, the outside air. Then we have an object originating from outside, refracts, it actually converges on a point and forms an image. With geometry, which we're not going to show here, we prove that if the index of refraction material 2 is greater than the index refraction of material 1, most likely the air, then the magnification would be equal to the image height or the object height, which we could prove to be a negative index 1 times image distance over index 2 times object distance. And also prove that the index 1 over object distance plus index 2 over image distance equals index 2 minus index 1 over the radius of curvature on this interface. Real images are formed on the side opposite from the object, so that we would consider the object distance to be positive distance because it's on the side of the real rays, even though they're refracted rays. So here's our sign conversion convention. The object distance is on the side of the origin. If it's on the side of the originating rays, say in front of the interface, and we assume that to be positive. If the object were on the opposite side, we assume that to be negative. Image, negative if it's in the side of the incoming rays, positive if it's on the side of the actual outgoing rays, where the real rays are. Same thing for the radius of curvature. If it's on the side of the outgoing rays, it's positive. And same convention for the height. So this is consistent with what we did for mirrors as well, because we're always comparing it to where the actual rays are as far as coming in and going out. Intuition expects P to be on the side of the incoming side, Q to be on the outgoing side, hence P and Q are positive if they're on the same side as the incoming or outgoing real light, respectively. Here's a flat refracting surface of the object coming out here, going from a higher index to a lower index, refracting away from the normal. Hence, it appears from these rays that are coming out from this refracting surface that they converge on a point, say the image. And in this case, the image would be formed on the same side as the incoming rays. So the image would actually be, the image distance would actually be negative. It's not on the side of the outgoing rays. Image is virtual. Since for a flat surface, R is infinity, if we applied that formula that we just introduced with that R being infinity, this would be something over infinity, which would be zero. So we'd have index 1 over object distance plus index 2 over image distance equals 0. Solve this for the image distance. That would be equal to negative index 2 over index 1 times the object distance. And if you're going from a higher index to a lower index, then that's going to be magnitude less than the object distance. For instance, one that got away. You're looking down at a fish submerged in the water. The fish is your source of your rays. So the rays are coming out here. They hit this surface, going from a higher index to a lower index, refract away from the normal. So it appears that these rays are actually converging from an image that is actually closer to the surface. What is the apparent depth of the fish as viewed from directly overhead? Well, using our last result for a radius of curvature of infinity, we have the image distance equals negative index 2 over index 1 times the object distance. Index 2 is the air, 1. Index 1 is the water. So negative 1 over 1.33 times d, or negative 0.75 d. So here's the fish, some distance deep below the water. The image is 3/4 of that distance below the water. Negative because it's on the opposite side of the outgoing rays. So if you try to catch that fish, based on where you think it is, you'll miss it by that much. If you miss it by 25%. Miss it by that much.
So always grab deeper than you think you've got to.
That's right. And that's or you get a spear or something. Is that legal? Spearfish? Probably not.
We got
it's the opposite effect if you're looking at the from the perspective of the fish. If you are the object and the light's coming in and refracts inwards, then according to the fish would think that you were further away from the surface than you actually were. So I don't know which is better. If you're the fish, then you know the danger doesn't look so bad. Either way. Here's a conceptual example. Let's say you're scuba diving. Let's say this. Objects viewed underwater with the naked eye often appear blurred and out of focus. It's because your eye is designed to be in air, at least looking in the air. A scuba diver using a mask, however, has a clear view of underwater objects. Explain how this works. I just gave it away. If you were swimming underwater, then what's going to happen to the surrounding? Your eyes are based naturally in an environment like this, whereas if you make that environment all water, index of refraction 1.33, and that's going to change all your optics, and it's not going to focus on your retina correctly. It might appear blurred. So if you're swimming underwater and you see what appears to be a nice, gentle manatee coming towards you, and instead, because it's blurred, you're not actually seeing the real thing, which is Bruce the shark. Of course, it's not the fish, not you, but I think it was Bruce, right?
Yes,
Bruce the shark.
Is anybody in here been snorkeling with manatees? That's awesome.
Yeah,
that's one fast.
Really?
Yeah, you think that you can reach out and try to touch one, and they like that big, huge thing goes, you got fins on it, and you can't catch it.
Is it possible that they might collide with you?
They go around you. I mean, it's possible, but.
They might be down.
Yeah, where was.
Maybe I didn't realize that it's belly, but it
wasn't really
its belly, but.
Were you in Boston? Where were you at?
It's in Florida. Somewhere.
Florida?
Yeah,
got nothing
hard.
What was you doing to the manatee?
Get that lick on the manatee.
Another example would be a mirage. Say you're looking at an object and you have the light directly coming to you, so you see this tree out in front. But there also might be light going in other directions. Say the light was going down below, but because of the temperature of the air, that changes the index of refraction of the air. And hence, light that might be coming down in this direction, in the direction of B, might be refracted due to the different layers of the temperature in the air, hence refracted back up towards you, and it appears that this light is coming from a different direction. Because as it comes in from this angle coming up, it appears that you got an image coming from this direction down here. So the observer would see both an upright and inverted image due to the direct light and the refracted light. An example, the mirage, you have the actual mountains in the background, and then you have what appears to be water surrounding objects here, but you're actually looking at the sky and the objects themselves being refracted through the hotter air below. Again, a similar image. You got trees here, and you got a refracted image below due to the heat. And if you were traveling through this desert in search of water, you might wrongly assume that this is a reflection off of water. That's what it looks like, and hence there might be an oasis there, but that's not true.
Hey, if there's trees there, there's water somewhere.
That's
desert training.
Good point. Mountains in the background, looks like there's an ocean around them. You even have a superior image. Or I guess it would get warmer as he went upward, so it actually might be refracted downward. So here you actually have some ice-type images coming downward from you, and it's a mirage, an inverted mirage. Same thing here. So you actually have an iceberg that looks like it's coming out of the sky. Could be a UFO, but most likely a refracted iceberg. I'm going to stop there today. That's a good day. Concave mirror has a focal length of 20 centimeters. What's position in centimeters of the resulting image if the image is inverted and four times smaller than the object? Magnification is the negative image distance or object distance. And we're told that this image is inverted and four times smaller. So this would be magnification of a negative 1/4 based on that. So simplifying this, multiplying both sides by negative 1, bring P over here and 4 over there. Let's say P is equal to 4Q from that information. Since it is a concave mirror, we would have 1 over the object distance plus 1 over the image distance equals 1 over the focal length. And so P is equal to 4Q. We have 1 over 4Q plus 1 over Q. We're told the focal length was 20 centimeters. So let's just remember that we're dealing with centimeters here. Put in 20 for the focal length. And let's see, multiply this top and bottom by 4. So I have 1 plus 4 over 4 cubed, 1 over 20. I'll have 4 cubed, 5 times 20. Cube, 100 divided by 4, or 25. So that would be the position of the resulting image. If the image is inverted and 4 times smaller than the object. Look at the very next one. A convex mirror has a focal length of minus 20 centimeters. What's the position of the resulting image if the image is upright and 4 times smaller than the object? Start out the same way. Magnification is negative Q or P. But if that's upright and the image to object size is 1 to 4, then we'd say that it's magnification 1/4. So solving for P, P equal negative 4 cubed. And we also have that 1 over P plus 1 over Q equals 1 over F, 1 over the object distance plus 1 over the image distance equals 1 over focal length. So we have 1 over negative 4 cubed plus 1 over Q equals 1 over negative 20, because it's a convex mirror. And solving this, multiply this by negative 4 up and top and bottom. So we have 1 minus 4 over negative 4 cubed equals negative 120. So negative 4 cubed equals negative 3 times negative 20. It's going to equal 60 divided by negative 4 or negative 15. So this image would be 15 centimeters behind the mirror, as it should be for a convex mirror. All your images will be behind the mirror. That's a good enough start.